This is my little documentary about my trip to England for my aunt's funeral. It was Aunt Anne, and she was also my godmother. And I hadn't been to England for quite some time. My father picked me up from Gatwick Airport, and we drove off to a little town called Alsford. But on the way, we stopped off at some of the little villages so I could film some of the sights. And the great thing about England is it never changes. It always seems to be the same old pubs and the churches and the old thatched roofs and the sheep. In fact, I was surprised by how many thatched roof cottages there were still, because back in the 80s, I remember hearing that it was a dying trade. It was one of these old form of roofing that was dying out, but it's clearly not. They seem to be everywhere. In fact, in one village alone, I think I counted about 20 houses that had a thatched roof. Anyway, now we've arrived in the little town of Alsford. This is where my Aunt Anne grew up with her sisters and her two brothers. And Alsford's right near Winchester. Winchester is the original capital of England, right back at the time of King Alfred the Great. But this isn't really relevant. This documentary's about Aunt Anne, and this was the little town that she and her family grew up in.
Just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away. And won't you please say hello to the folks that I know? Tell them I won't be long. They'll be happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing this song. We'll meet again.
This is Alsford House. This is where they grew up. And during the war, Aunt Anne and her sisters were evacuated out of England and lived in America. For 5 years they were there. They didn't see their parents at all during those 5 years.
In the Second World War, you and your two sisters were sent to America, weren't you?
Yes. Cable after cable came from Aunt Isabel and Uncle Bill. Send the children. Well, Hitler was expected to land 3 dates, and the bombing was going to be ghastly, and, you know, if Hitler invaded, it would be murder. So they won out. I don't think my mother ever wanted us to go, but maybe my father thought it would be a good idea. And nobody would have sent their children away if they'd known the war was going to drag on for 5 years. So we took a train from London to Liverpool, and the one thing I do remember was a great sort of excitement for me. I had my little 2-year-old sister, and we were taken by a Scottish nanny who was about 5 foot tall.
How old
and
you?
She was called Nanny Brown, and I was 9 and a half. And we were on the train waving my mother, I don't know who my father was, goodbye. And I turned round, and there was my darling sister Anne, aged 12, tears pouring down her face. And I thought, I'm going to have a boo-hoo too. Never occurred to me before that. And before we left, we had been living in London. Then, 6 months before the war broke out, my parents found a house in Hampshire. And that was in April in 1939. And we left in July, or the end of June, on this ship from Liverpool.
Later in the 1960s and 70s, I remember coming here many times when I was a boy with my sisters, and it was a great house to explore. Alsford House had been the family home for the Maxwells for quite some time. It's now since been sold. This is the little church right beside Alsford House. I don't think they went to this church because they had their own Catholic chapel at Alsford House. But Aunt Anne's brother and father are buried in this cemetery. This is my uncle's grave. This is William Constable Maxwell. He was 23 when he died. He was in the RAF and training for an air show when he crashed, and I was named after him. Beside him is Gerald Constable Maxwell. This is Aunt Anne's father and my grandfather. He was an ace pilot in World War I, and in World War II he commanded an air squadron, one of the air squadrons that would have helped to win the Battle of Britain.
Ship. We all made about 1,000 children, I think, on the ship. And I have a little newspaper cutting. It was all rather spectacular. I discovered that the convoy, we were in convoy, although you couldn't see other ships at all, but it was the most heavily armed convoy in that ever crossed the Atlantic with children on board as well, because of gold bullion going to America with us. But we went via the Halifax and then on to New York, where we were met by my aunt and uncle. And then from then on, we became little Americans. But
did you talk to your parents on the telephone occasionally?
No, there was no telephone. But we, about 2 years after living in America, there was a sort of radio connection. We were hooked up to our parents. And we were told green light and you could talk to your... We hadn't seen our parents for 2 years. And, hello, Mummy, hello, Daddy. Oh, darling, how are you? I'm all right. We're beginning to get like American accents by then. They sounded very, very, very English. And that was the only time we talked to our parents.
Now we're at Lake House. This is just down the road from Alsford House. Aunt Anne's youngest sister lives here, Aunt Rosebud, with her husband Tony. And there was many weekends that I would come here when I was living in England and play with my two cousins, Dominic and Sebastian. But like I said, the great thing about England is that everything always just seems to stay the same. It's just still the beautiful country that I always remembered.
Hey, Dad. I mean, I just want to film you.
Oh, you don't want to do anything unwise, Bill.
This is my father, Timothy.
You know that. You've had me long enough to know that.
And he also went into the churchyard and
Yeah, I filmed it.
This is Aunt Rosebud.
Oh.
Isn't that good?
That's absolutely amazing. Gosh, that's good.
We haven't let the grass grow under our feet, Rosebud.
Oh, no.
We tried to, but we couldn't stop it.
Hi, Mom.
Good Lord.
Hello.
This is my mother, Diana, Aunt Anne's sister.
Bill, what fun. Hello, I've had my hair done.
That evening, several of my cousins came and visited. And I hadn't seen them in a long time, so it was nice that they dropped by. It was just like good old times again, except we were all a bit older.
Billy! Are you filming, Billy?
No, no. Say hello. Yeah.
Hello, Bill.
No, say hello to yourself.
Oh, hello, Tuft.
Hello, Tuft.
That's not her real name, but everyone always called her Tufty.
Mobs. Mobs.
Oh, is it not?
And this is her sister, Mobs. That's also not her real name. Their parents came up with those nicknames for the girls. There's Uncle Tony. And this is Mungo. Last time I saw Mungo, he looked like this.
Having a nice birthday, Mungo?
Please.
Just a little boy. Now he's a doctor. This is Sebastian. They also call him Seb.
Is it red? Is it a red dot there?
Yes, hold on. I can find the red dot. Okay, Seb?
Yeah.
It's filming.
It's filming. Now you got him sideways.
I've got him backwards. Okay, Seb.
He's done it before. He'll do it again. Can you always
tell us all about yourself, Seb?
Well,
we arrived, but we're coming up from the trend from.
Let me talk about it.
Have a drink, Seb, and you'll feel better.
Okay. That's a very good idea. My political career is not going terribly well, actually. I found that nobody would vote for me.
Anyone would like some toppering, take it and break a piece off and pass it round.
Haven't you got any milk, Toblerone?
No, I certainly haven't.
There we go. There.
Bill, are you a man? Can you break that piece of Toblerone off?
Can you give me a hand?
I will tell
you.
I'm
going to
get you.
Not
this.
There we go.
Hello. You have switched it on.
I'm using up all of Bill's film.
It's my voice and massive sound.
Do you want my battery?
No, I don't.
You can now use up all your film.
Yeah.
Oh God, you're on sand.
God.
I shouldn't fade in too much, Bill. Keep it nice and blurry and fade in.
It's like a motorbike just sees really. Totally different
Will I take 10?
You must have gone to school there.
I went to three schools. I was so dumb in all of them. Anne, of course, worked her like a beaver. Always into her homework and getting A's and brilliant. And I think I was probably, Tim swears I'm dyslexic, and I found work rather difficult anyway. But there was a nice school, it was the Holy Child School in Summit. So off Anne and I, with our school books and all, bicycled to and from all the time. And that...
Anne tells a sad story about how your mother required you all to come back at a certain point, and that Anne wasn't able to sit her exams or something like that.
Yes, that's quite true. Anne came back with our darling Nanny Brown. So Anne was turned 17, and she could help with the war effort, probably. And therefore, Anne was allowed to come back to England in 1944. Normandy landings, don't forget. And Nanny came with her. And of course, it was wonderful, because by that time, my parents had two more children. And most nannies were not available, because they were helping with the war effort. So the nanny supply was pretty unreliable, and Mummy, I suppose, thought that it'd be lovely to get one of her children back, and it would be awfully nice to have a nanny take care of the two youngest ones. Anne was removed from school in America, by which time she was in Connecticut and Sacred Heart Convent. She was removed from school, where she was within a year, even. She was an incredible star. She had a blue ribbon, which you take 4 years usually to acquire, and she acquired this marvellous honour. And Anne came back with Nanny, the two little teeny-weeny brother and sister. The house was huge. It was cold because no heating. My father was in hospital having had a crashed the plane taking off after lunch, having lunch at Arundel Park, and the wind suddenly turned and my father crashed and broke his kneecap. So by the time Anne got back, it was only our darling Mama in the house, who everybody was tired by then and cold, and war-torn England was really not a fun place to get back to on your own, especially. And Anne was then put on the watercress, never could finish that last year in education, and that's what irritated all her life. And I can see her point. She was such a success at school, and suddenly to be torn from that.
Okay, so now this is Mungo. We're driving off to the funeral at Arundel. And there's the GPS. That thing's pretty useful. You barely even have to look at the road. Just look at the little monitor there and follow that. Anyway, we still managed to get lost a couple of times. But we will get there eventually. But we made it.
This is where I can film myself with a...
Okay, we've just arrived in Arundel, small little town, and we're all just traipsing off to the cathedral for Aunt Anne's funeral. That's Arundel Castle. That's where Aunt Anne and her family lived from time to time. on walking. Look normal. Okay, so we're all heading into the cathedral now. I wasn't sure if I should bring my camera in. A couple of people may have suggested maybe not, and in fact I thought so too, that I probably shouldn't, because most people do not bring movie cameras into funerals. But I figured this is an important event. This is my aunt and my godmother, and it's something that I think I'd like to see in years to come, and I think many other people might as well. So I thought, well, okay, my camera's just a little camera. I'll be discreet, and I'm going to film as much of it as I can. So here we go. This is Aunt Anne's funeral.
They're all numbered, so
four.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Exactly.
The cops and us.
That's right. They can't be long.
No, they can't be long. They must
I'm going to be...
Their married life had an early tragic blow, death of Robert.
the army, following the flag, as you put it. 15 years and so many years, puts I as chairman in Kenya and Berlin. She was a dedicated and commanding officer wife. She supported the sergeant's wives and other junior wives. She had a history, then as later, of sticking up for those who were less than able to speak for themselves. Their formal charm and determination. And then personal relationships with staff and supporters. And above all, she loved to talk with patients. She felt at home doing so, listening to their problems and understanding. She never stood on her own and was self-advocating. She was never fearful of people's illness. Like Princess Diana, close friend, she was at ease and providing comfort at their bedside. She was determined to have the best possible care. At the end of that life, when diagnosed with cancer, she was deeply shocked and troubled. She knew better than anyone what it meant. She faced the crisis with her usual courage and determination, also with laughter. Teenies by her side, her family and friends. She had the quality of being naturally humble towards her maker and towards those who were educated to contact. Someone said she never knew true growth. So we can end as we started with Thomas Moore, St. James Moore. On the way to the scaffold, he said to his friends and foe alike, in a little while, all of us here can look forward to it.
Camera was running out of batteries during the funeral, so I only filmed parts of it. This is Dominic. He's my first cousin, and when I was living in England, I'd say he was my best friend. In fact, I would say he probably still is. There was about 800 or 900 people there at Aunt Anne's funeral. She raised a lot of money for the charities and the hospices, so I'm sure a lot of people came out from all over England to pay their respects, plus the locals from the town of Arundel, as well as her friends and family. Some of my relatives I haven't seen in 20 years even, and some of them, last time I saw them, were little kids. Now, they've got little kids of their own. Aunt Anne raised millions of pounds for the hospices around England. And this was for people who were dying, people who were terminally ill. And this aid was basically for these people who don't have a lot of money. And this will just basically make their last remaining days on this earth just a little better before they die. And that's a beautiful cause. And that's what Aunt Anne devoted her life to. Tens of millions of pounds that were raised for the less fortunate. And Aunt Anne dedicated pretty much most of her life to that. And for that, she will be deeply missed. And she has truly left behind a beautiful legacy. So I'd just like to close off by saying that funerals are never a happy event. However, they are inevitable for everyone. But one thing I can say about them is they do bring families together. For people who haven't seen each other in many, many years, it's an opportunity for everyone to say hello again. It brought me back to England. I hadn't seen most of my relatives in years, so that's one thing I can be always grateful to my Aunt Anne for, giving me an opportunity to see everyone again. And that's a small thing, but it meant a lot to me. But a big farewell to Aunt Anne, and a hello to all of my relatives again. It did bring us all back together again for just a final farewell. But to all my relatives, till we meet again, thank you, and thank you all for watching this little documentary. Bye-bye.
Thank you. another chapter of Billy's life began.